This is when I was trying to reconnect with the Maritimes. This series started in around 2016. So this is a photograph that I'm sure all of you can relate to.
Yeah.
That's my little brother, Raph, who's unfortunately unable to be here. And this photo was taken by my father, who's in the front row. So we would go on a lot of trips to PEI, as I'm sure all of you did every summer. And so Dad would kind of like, sorry Dad, he would like make us pose in front of a lot of really touristy sites. Which at the time, I'll be honest, I didn't like it. But in retrospect, he gave me a lot of material. It worked out.
Now you appreciate me.
So I used a lot of his photographs for references for this whole series, but that's the only one I'll show of his. So this is Alma Valley. As you know, it no longer exists, but this is my way of trying to reconnect to those memories. This was done with charcoal and vine charcoal and erasure, so a lot of like adding and subtracting and adding and subtracting until I got the final image of what I wanted. These works are also from that series. The one on the right, A Lighthouse, is actually here downstairs in a group show curated by Amy Ash called Harbor, which I highly recommend you go see because there are a lot of amazing artists also involved in that show. Again, thinking about erasure and addition, and I guess how that relates to memory. This is called Campers from 2017. I have a horrible relationship with camping. I never liked it, and I am not ashamed to admit that I'm not an outdoorsy type. I prefer the standard comforts. So this was me kind of like wishing that I loved camping, because of course all my friends loved it and have all these memories doing it. So here I am painting a pretty picture of campers. This is another one. This was taken before it was finished, so it's changed a little bit. It's a work in progress. I'll get to it maybe in a few years, I don't know. Also, another camping scene. I was thinking a lot about the empty chair at this time too, kind of representing my absence in these narratives that a lot of people in the Maritimes have that I don't. But also trying to idealize these places, because I feel like I did miss out on a lot by not loving camping. I know it's so simple, but. So this is Suburbia, which is on the wall over there. Suburbia. This is a tough one because, so initially there was a figure right here. It was actually my own head, and I was like looking straight at the viewer, and then I was like, why am I putting myself in this image? It's horrible. And I erased it, and I added these children because I felt it was, I was trying to be a little less literal in the story of Suburbia. Suburbia is kind of a generic, it's a generic place that it's bits and pieces from my memory of my own neighborhood, but I definitely put a lot of imagination into my imagery. I don't want them to be set places that people recognize. So again, just trying to be playful and rewrite these memories. Memories that I don't necessarily find positive.
Put us silent.
This is Dixon Falls. So what am I going to say about Dixon Falls? I guess I'll go into a little bit about water. This was my interest in water was beginning to happen. So I was painting a lot of waterfalls. And the reason being is that I actually am terrified of deep water. So. Again, no camping and no skinny dipping in deep water, no, you know, Boating terrified me, although it didn't, because I had to growing up in the Maritimes. although I love water, I really do, I promise. I just don't like getting deep in it. So yeah, that's kind of what that's about. These are shots of my show in Montreal at the Belleville Building, where I showed Home and Haven for the first time, which was really important for me. It was a few years after I graduated. And it was my first time showing my community in Montreal themes about my home in New Brunswick. And yeah, I think that's all I can say about that. Here's another shot. My friend Aiden. Someone's phone ringing. No? Okay, I have background music.
Okay. Go for it.
Show at the Belleville Building. Yeah, that's all I have to say about that. So we'll go into the third one, water. And I'm thinking about water in general terms. I already told you my association to it. So again, just as proof, I have a lot of photos of myself with water just to prove that I loved it. But I'm never really in it. Madeline's not here, but that's okay. Is she here? Oh, hi. Sorry, Maddie. That's my cousin, Madeline, 9 years ago on Capelet in Shediac, my aunt and uncle's place. So I'll move into my residency on Toronto Island. So I did this residency in September of 2018. This is a view from the ferry looking onto the city, and this is my bike that I had the whole time I was there, and I had a lot of alone time, so this was happening after I had left Montreal. I lived in Montreal for 13 years, and this was actually like my first time having a real big stint of nature again, so it was really inspiring. Thinking a lot about water and what I was going to do at this residency, I wanted to attack this fear of water. There's some rocks. I don't know if any of you know Colin Crothers. I just love that photo of him on the left, so I had to include it. He visited me for a day there. So I was getting a little isolated. these are some people that I met at the residency. It was a mix of people from all over the world, from New York and Amsterdam. Natalie on the left was an amazing dancer, and Rusha on the right was an amazing photographer. So it was like an opportunity to get out of the studio and out of the isolation. Even though I'm in nature and I'm isolated, it's like a way to, it was a great way to meet international artists. This is Natalie giving a lovely performance. And this is the whole group. So there was a great mix of us. So what I did at this residency was I decided to physically go into Lake Ontario and fetch the water from Lake Ontario, even though I was terrified, and only use that water to make art. So that was my goal at this residency. And it was kind of like a private performance of enacting like the archetypal maritimer, if that makes sense. So all of these watercolors on Mylar were done with Lake Ontario water. You can't see it in these photos, but there's like bits of sand in it, which gives a really nice effect. And they were actually really fun to do because it was also a big break from oil painting, which can be pretty laborious. Here's another one. So these ranged from really, really big to really, really small. This is called In Tandem. It was shown at Atsikun, which is an artist-run center in Montreal. It's actually a place that's very dear to my heart. Here it is. It's an artist-run center. It's the oldest one in Canada, I believe. And their mandate is an anti-oppressive mandate, so their goal is to really feature people from marginalized communities. And it's just a great group of people who come in and out of there all the time, so I was really grateful to be a part of that. This is at the opening. So this work you will also see downstairs in the Harbor Show. It's called At This Juncture. It was also done at this residency. And here's a detail. There's another detail. So it's really just water and watercolor on Mylar. And what I really loved about it is I could erase it at any time with water, which you can't really do with oil. It takes a lot more. So it was very forgiving, this work. So I'm going to go into my fourth point, which is hybridity and this show, Other People's Gardens. Let's get my notes. I have this weird obsession with watching other people's gardens, literally watching them grow. So in Montreal, I'd go to work and I would like pay attention to their little tiny gardens and like see how they changed over time. This was actually taken in Cuba. I'm just like touching someone else's tree because I do things like that. This is me volunteering to create a garden at a place of work in Montreal, actually. It was like it was a restaurant, and this was the tapas, and so that was a really fun project. I did not get a green thumb like my mother did. I grew up in a really beautiful garden, but I don't have those skills, so I think there's kind of a feeling of longing with that. This was my walk to my old studio in Montreal. This is what I saw every day. And I would just watch that tree change colors, so that tree is like my best friend, even though it's not mine. Also me touching other people's gardens. I don't know why I'm so honest.
Oh my God.
Here we have my grandparents. I'm gonna try not to get emotional. This is kind of where this work comes into play. Before my grandmother passed, she told me a lot of stories. And she told me a few about serpents. And if some of you have had a chance to see this show, you're probably wondering where the serpent imagery comes from. And it comes from her stories. So she has the story of, I'll just say one of them. She's in a field and she's a kid and she's sleeping. But Lebanon is really hot, right? So she was sweating, but then she woke up feeling like rejuvenated and really cool. And she realized there was a snake around her. So the snake was actually keeping her cool. And it just stuck with me. And so I started researching snakes and serpents. And this is the whip snake was actually quite popular in Lebanon. So snakes happened. And these are details of these two paintings here. So on the left is kind of this portal of that painting on the right. I kind of think of these as different fragments of past and present and fragments of stories and memories that I don't even rely on because you can't really rely on other people's memories, but I really do find that interesting in trying to kind of recreate this storytelling whimsical narrative. I also became obsessed with like how snakes move. I don't know if you've ever watched YouTube videos, but like there's so many of them and it's kind of gross, but it's really interesting to just watch how they move. So I started painting them. These are bits of that painting there. This is a studio shot of me making those paintings in my old studio in Montreal, and it's taken from the ceiling. I got like such a good workout painting those. You have to like go on stepping stools and step back to see the image, and it's just like a whole embodied experience. I'm not even looking at my notes, I'm probably missing a lot, but it's okay. So this is a show, this is my first show in Guelph, which is where I now live. It was the MFA show, and I'm just kind of showing it to give you a glimpse into like what my life is right now. I'm living in a bubble of academia, which I absolutely love, and it's agony and ecstasy. So I thought I would just share that with you. This is a shot of my studio. There's some beautiful skylight, and I'm really grateful to have this space right now because you cannot get that for a good price anywhere. This is just kind of like works in progress. That's it. I'm just gonna go through these. There's another one. This is a work that's not here right now, but it is part of the series. There's not much to say about it other than I guess I'm kind of replacing the figures that you saw in the beginning of this presentation with kind of these objects that are representative of my own culture, but I'm trying to still figure them out. So,
it's my favorite one.
Just by going through the internet and finding these, you know, these places that are actually meaningful in my family history, but I have no connection to. So there is a distance, and I think you can kind of see that in final paintings. Where did I put that in there? This is my committee at school looking at my work and scrutinizing me. So this is what it's like to be at the University of Guelph right now. Okay, so I guess now we will go into my current work, which, these two and this one are part of this series. Okay, so I'll begin by talking about the Orientalist painters. So I'm looking into scholars like Edward Said, who have kind of changed the discourse of how we look at the Middle East, how the West has a history of representing the East. So I just started looking into his vast writing. There's so much out there. But I'm just going to pinpoint on this one thing. So the Orientalist painters, as you all know. So oil painting at the time was obviously a way to share information, let's say, of the Middle East. But it was not always based in fact. So for instance, this painting by Jean-Léon Jérôme. So it's set in a harem, in a bathhouse, but it's showing the agili, so what you smoke out of. And the misleading thing about this is that there were not actually agilis in the bathhouses, because that was a place of bathing, and that was a place of cleanliness. So this is kind of like an exoticization of these places. Again, sharing information that is not true. So here's another one. You get the idea. So I've been thinking about what that kind of sharing of information means today. And so of course, oil painting has been replaced by photography. And I'm focusing more on the stock image as a way to talk about how information is shared and the commodification of Middle Eastern culture through stock photography. So this is a building in Beirut. It's a mosque. And so what I do is I kind of go to Getty Images and I go to Shutterstock. And I set myself some parameters, like, oh, I'm just gonna look at, let's say, the creative and the most popular. And then I'll type in, let's say, Beirut. And a lot of these images will come up. So it's not overtly doing anything wrong, but what I'm doing is I'm researching how this information is deployed and how it's given to us through these systems. So also being a New Brunswicker, having been born and raised here, it's a way that I discover my own culture, right? So I'm just Googling things, because I've been there once when I was 10 years old, which was amazing, but I don't know that much about it. So these are all things I'm thinking about in my current research in school. So this is this small painting here. And I guess what I'm trying to do is bring back meaning from these static images that are kind of like prim and proper and photoshopped, and I'm trying to bring them back into painting because for me, I think oil painting especially, and I'm kind of biased because I'm obsessed with oil painting, but I think it's alive. I think paintings are always alive, whereas the photographic image is static. That's how I perceive them. So I'm trying to kind of bring meaning back into these images and these subjects. These are just examples of the same building over and over again. This is some more editorial stock images that I'm looking at. So a lot of smoke. I mean, this is of course related to what's been happening in Lebanon right now. So, and it's also, I'm searching from my own computer, which has certain algorithms. So it would probably be different if I was on my friend's computer, which I actually tried and it's not that different. There's some more images that come up a lot. So the imagery of smoke has been pretty in our face when we Google Middle East or when we Google Lebanon. So this is one of the latest paintings I did of a tire burning. And again, I'm just trying to bring feeling and meaning and life back into these images. My practice just kind of asks more questions than gives more answers. So that's where I'm at. This is another one that I did just a few months ago, and I didn't bring it here because it was way too wet and John would have yelled at me and show it. This is the last one, fog. I'm gonna end it there. Thank you. Oh. I still love color and I still explore color because I think color holds a lot of meaning, but I think in order to explore what my concerns are now, I have to reduce the color because color can also bring in a whole world of more questions, if that makes any sense. Yeah.
Right. So your current work, it seems to not have many figures in it at all, so it's almost completely abandoned, like what you began from. Mm-hmm. But what would you say is like a thread that goes through all of it? Like what do you find through
like
all of your
from
work? Yeah, like do you find that there's, do you find that there's something like a thread that kind of goes through?
That's a really good question. I think I've been really needing to get back to the figure, to be honest with you. I took the figure out since I started school. Mm-hmm. And school does weird things to you. Mm-hmm. You know, you bring in academia to art and then you're like, bam, I can't think about this way. I have to think about it this way and I have to talk about it this way. And so I think removing the figure allowed me to talk about my ideas easier. Mm-hmm. But I definitely do plan on bringing it back.
Okay.
I know that doesn't really answer your question.
No.
I
asked with an answer in my head,
right,
that I thought you might say, so that wasn't really fair.
Okay.
So, like, for me, I see, like, sort of a longing through all of it.
Yeah,
like,
sure.
A yearning and a longing, that's, like...
Yeah, that's definitely...
That's my take.
Thank you.
Yeah,
no problem. Anyone else? I'm so Chris.
I have a good question. I was wondering about your comment about how long was passionate and anguish with respect to academe. I know that you grew up in an artist's household. Your parents were in fashion and photography before your dad, you know, really
mm-hmm.
committed himself full time to fine arts.
Mm-hmm.
And you've been in this trajectory of, you know, the theory and the academic grounding
yeah.
in fine arts for 10 years or more through your BA and MFA.
Yeah.
And so I'm wondering how that relates to your comment and how you see at this juncture in your life, practice and theory.
Okay. So you're asking how does agony and ecstasy relate to my experience in academia?
Agony and ecstasy.
I mean, I don't think it's limited to just those in academia. I think a lot of artists can relate to the agony and ecstasy thing. And it's not to perpetuate the narrative, oh, this is like, I'm an artist, I'm crazy, it's okay. Like, that's not what I'm saying at all. But I guess I can talk about it in more practical terms. Like, I had a critique, which was like one of the hardest things I've ever had to do, where it's basically like a thesis defense. We have to do this 4 times before graduating, and they are just shutting you down and asking you what you're doing. And that's the agony, but then the ecstasy is what follows, like how much you learn from it. Like, so it's really a roller coaster, and it's like having a show, you know, I know Marie, you probably relate to this, like there's a build up to the opening and then it's all over all of a sudden. So you kind of go through this weird depression, and it's like, there's no, I think that's what I meant. Anyone else? I really do appreciate all of you being here, and it means a lot to me, and I'm holding back tears right now. Thank you all for coming. Thank you.